Most of the LTTs, Kada grave sites, or the Mahavira Thiruvamilams, have been completely desecrated. It has been bulldozed. Those graveyards have been literally excavated, and military camps have in fact been built on quite a few of them, totally disrespecting, and not only that, leaving no room or any semblance of identities left for those graveyards for people, for their families to come and pay respect. Now it is this military that we see in Sri Lanka that completely goes against all forms of humanity, continuing a structural genocidal process even after the end of the war, over the last 8 years. This same military is being accepted by the international community that talks in terms of good governance, democracy, rule of law, and all these esteemed principles. The international community have absolutely no qualms in accepting this very same military that stands accused of genocide and crimes against humanity and war crimes in peacekeeping missions around the world. The military high personnel are accepted as ambassadors in those respective countries. There has been nothing that has been done concretely by these countries that talk in terms of democracy and good governance and human rights to bring the Sri Lankan military to book. Quite the contrary, if you look at the events that happened in Geneva, the clear message in the way the United States and the other countries that supported the resolutions in Geneva, the way they behaved, was that the message that was given was that, look, we have a problem with Mahinda Rajapaksa. We continue to increase the pressure when Mahinda Rajapaksa was in power. We named and shamed the Sri Lankan government and the military. But when a government that was much more favorable to it came into power, we did the complete opposite. We allowed the very same military and the very same personalities that we named and shamed during the previous regime. We turned a blind eye. We were quite happy to have very close relations with them. We were quite happy to form military units, help form military units, carry military exercises, all of which we were not prepared to do with the previous regime, or we pretended not wanting to do with the previous regime. So I think everything becomes crystal clear when you look at it in that context, that what we have and the attitudes that the international community has, whether it be with regards to Tamil commemoration or whether it be with regards to the way in which these countries deal with the Sri Lankan military, all of that has to do with which regime is in power. If it's a regime that those respective countries have no problems in accepting, that look after their interests in the region, then those countries are willing to tolerate anything. But at the same time, if those countries have to face with a government that is not favorable to it, that is acting in a manner that compromises their interests in this region, then those countries take up the question of human rights, the behavior of the military, the fact that people are not able to commemorate, all of these things, to try and name and shame the government. So I think in the absence of any effort to, number one, acknowledge that the Sri Lankan state is the problem, that it is the ethnocracy that Sri Lanka is, that is the fundamental cause of all the problems in Sri Lanka, in this island, and that Sri Lankan state, that ethnocracy has to be dismantled, and reconstructed in a plurinational sense that recognizes not only the Sinhala nation as the custodians of the state but also the Tamil nation. Until those structural changes are done and until the international community addresses those changes, I think everything else that takes place is merely geopolitical in character and only is self-serving. Internationally, commemorating the dead, remembering the dead is something that is an accepted norm. No matter what your political affiliations may be, whether you are seen on whichever political divide you find yourself in, the fact is that people are entitled as of right to commemorate their dead and to respect their dead and to remember them. That is happening all over the world. The Japanese in World War II commemorate their dead. No matter which way, you may view those sacrifices. The same happens in Germany, the same happens in the United States, all over the world, no matter which war, the dead are commemorated. In Sri Lanka, you have a situation that is the complete opposite. You have the state that monopolizes on the right of commemoration. It is the state armed forces that are commemorated. The Tamils, whether it be LTT cadres or for that matter even Tamil civilians who lost their lives due to genocide that was committed against them, are prevented from commemorating. In fact, it is literally the Tamil people commemorating is a sign of resistance, resisting the state apparatus that prevents it from commemorating. So that is the reality in which we find ourselves. Even last year, during the Great Heroes Day week, there were various commemorations that took place. But the Sri Lankan state was opposed to it. They tried in various ways to prevent it. But when the general public and the families of the great heroes chose to go beyond government diktats and go ahead with their commemoration, there was a situation that events overtook and the government let things be. I of course have been quite clear, the previous government which was totally dependent on the TNA for their support and to gain legitimacy in the international arena had to in some way show something to the Tamil people by way of some sort of achievement that the Tamil people managed to get, or in particular the TNA managed to get during the last 2.5 during the last Maithripala Sirisena Ranil Wickremesinghe regime, when they were not able to deliver on accountability and a political solution, which were the two main concerns of the Tamil people. They had to at least show that there was some forward movement on other matters. And the best way to do it is with regards to emotional matters, not substantive matters, but rather emotional matters. And it was under those circumstances that the government was paying lip service to saying that they were opposed to these commemorations taking place. Ultimately, allowed it to go ahead. And let us not forget that it was the government's partners, the TNA, that actively took part in organizing those in those events, in those Mahavir Thiruvallams, which is the resting places of great heroes. So very clearly there was a political agenda. It was a question of wanting to gain some sort of legitimacy in the eyes of the Tamil people, whose representatives were fundamentally instrumental in legitimizing the defaulting regime from a Tamil point of view to the international community, and thereby in some way pacifying the Tamil people to show that they had achieved something which the Rajapaksa regime previously did not permit. So those were cosmetic efforts. In this instance, it is true that the first on the 21st of this month, the TID had approached the police and had asked them to file a motion in the courts, in the Jaffna Magistrates Court, seeking a ban on commemoration events that were to take place. When the TID approached the courts, they approached it without any individuals' names being mentioned. So that in itself is flawed. The reason why they didn't do it is because the General Secretary of the Tamil National People's Front, Mr. Selvaraja Gajendran, who was also the coordinator of the committee, that citizens committee that had been created to organize these commemorations in Kopai and in other areas, wrote a letter to the police seeking permission to use loudspeakers for this particular week. And on that basis, he had given the address of the particular private property in which these commemoration events were to take place, and that he very clearly mentioned that these were to commemorate the dead. So it is on that basis that the police approached the magistrate's court, but did not want to mention the General Secretary Selvaraja Gajendran's name, because they did not want any possible political mileage that could be got from mentioning the name, because the moment they mention the name, that name will be associated with the Tamil National People's Front, which is a political party. So since the application also was fundamentally flawed, the magistrate eventually gave an order saying that provided the LTT as a banned organization is not commemorated directly, in the sense that no LTT paraphernalia, whether it be photographs or flags or any other symbol depicted the LTT or directly correlated with the LTT, which was listed in the PTA, that people could commemorate nonetheless. So that was the order given, and as such, the fact of the matter is that since you have the PTA that that bans these acts, we have carried on with organizing the event, obviously without doing anything that will invoke the PTA and allowing the government to use that as an opportunity to victimize the public who want to commemorate. So that is the situation that prevails. I think the larger, more important factor is once again how insecure the Sri Lankan state is. I mean, the fact that on the one hand they claim that they had vanquished the LTT and that they had they are the victors, but very clearly behaving in the most insecure possible way, a state that has that claims to have won a war. Is behaving, and I think those are indicative of the Sinhala Buddhist ethnocracy that Sri Lanka actually is, that anything that is symbolic in challenging that supremacist ideology has to be resisted and has to be in some way contained, simply because that ideology is unable to compete. It's unable to compete with competing identities that are very dominant in this island, particularly the Tamil nation. So it is in that context that these commemorations of the Tamils are being to a great extent targeted. The JVP, on the other hand, is an organization that once again worked against the state. Carried out two insurgencies against the Sri Lankan state because it wanted to change the character of the state. There were enough crimes that took place during those insurgencies. But the Sri Lankan state does not feel insecure, primarily because even the JVP is a single nationalist party, although it claims to have leftist ideals. Fundamentally, it is a racist, single nationalist party, supremacist party. And since that identity of the ethnocracy that Sri Lanka, the Sri Lankan state is, was never challenged by the JVP in any real sense, that organization's commemorations of their great heroes is perfectly acceptable to the single nationalist ethnocracy project. So that is how I see the two different attitudes with regards to commemoration.